Hi everyone. Sorry about that. We had a little glitch in our orientation here of our screen, so we had to kind of restart it a little bit. But we are here. Happy Monday. So glad that you all have joined us today for our Monday live stream. All the sirens went by too all of a sudden. So you guys are really getting it here on a Monday morning, Monday afternoon now. Hope you had a great weekend. We're ha so happy to be here with you. And what's that going on behind me? Camera guy, what you doing there? Is he playing tennis?
No, I got my bug
Oh,
zapper.
that's right, the bug zapper. Okay, I don't know if you guys remember last week,
Yes.
but Jerry mentioned this. We have had so many bugs here in Southern California. If you're in Southern California, raise your hand. So Jerry got this bug zapper here, and he's having a good old time with it, as you can see. Are you having any luck there, Jerry?
Yeah, actually I am, and there's been a lot of comments about it. It is so satisfying to hear those gnats.
Sorry.
So yeah, it's a total blast. And the Japanese beetles,
Oh, yeah.
I swat them right out like a baseball bat, and I don't know where they end up, but it's a blast. So
They go flying, let me tell you. It's kind of fun because we heard one land like way out in the garden yesterday. And those Japanese beetles are so aggressive. They literally fly right at my hair and will literally like attach themselves to my head. So I count on Jerry to keep them away. I don't know about during the live stream, though. But yeah, we love that thing. And as you can tell, we're hurting for entertainment around here. So, but I did put a link for that in the video description. So if you want to grab one, it really works well. So Jerry's having a great time. So anyway,
all right, I'm back to the
welcome.
chat.
Jerry's back in the chat. And welcome again. Welcome to Cliff and Nisha, our moderators who are here every single week, keeping us on track. And to Smart Pots, our container garden experts, who are here in the chat to answer your container garden questions. We love to provide you here on the live streams with tons of resources to make your vegetable growing fun, as you can tell from Jerry, and helpful, and to make your vegetable growing successful. So that's what we're here for, and just to have a good time. And today's topic is a fun one. It's from garden to living room, some tips to move your vegetables indoors for the winter. So before we get into that, let me say hello to others of you who are here. Love it that you set your time aside to join us every Monday at noon Pacific time. And before I forget, we're taking a brief hiatus. We will not be live streaming next Monday, which is the 16th, and the following Monday, which is the 23rd. A hiatus for 2 weeks, and then we'll be back on the 30th. So make sure you set that time appointment on your calendars that we will be off for the next 2 weeks and back again on the 30th. Okay, Nicole, is it all what Jerry anticipated with the bug zapper? Yes, it absolutely is, and more. He literally comes out here just to zap the bugs sometimes. And I mentioned that California is being infested with bugs, especially mosquitoes. We don't normally have a lot of mosquitoes. So when we had that hurricane, it brought in so much moisture, a lot more than we've ever had in the summertime. And with it came the bugs. So literally every time I come outside, I have to spray myself down with bug repellent. Otherwise, I am just bit everywhere and itching all day long. So if you're in Southern California, I want to know if you've had that problem too and how you're taking care of it in the garden. Okay, Connie Davidson is here. Hello, Connie. How are you doing? V, oh my gosh, what am I going to do without all my Monday friends? I know we're going to miss you all too. And I look forward to being back with you. And maybe you guys can hang out on Instagram or something like that. But yeah, we'll miss you guys too. Deb, hello. How are you? PT Treadway, Patricia, great to have you here today as always. And Patricia was saying earlier in the pre-live stream chat, which by the way, that starts at 11:30. So you really can't go wrong on a Monday morning hanging out with us here, or a Monday afternoon, no matter where you're at. She was saying how it's heading back up into the 90s this week in Southern Arizona. Had a little brief reprieve and now heading up. So I want to know in the chat, what's the weather like in your neck of the woods? Are things cooling down, heating up? We had a week of 90 degree weather, 90 plus, almost 100 digit day or triple digit day, one or two of those days. And now we're back into a very comfortable 80 degrees, maybe in the 80s all week long and even into the 70s. So it's really, really nice. Definitely getting cooler at night, which is a good time to bring those plants. And we'll get into that in just a moment. Kathy Crowley, hello. Yes, invisible mosquitoes biting, especially around the ankles. I have to say, Kathy, the same thing. And I know she lives here in SoCal as well. A friend of mine actually called them no-see-ums, no-see-ums, right? Because you can't see them. They're just biting your ankles. I don't know if that's a real thing. I think that's going on. That's a term in Florida. So, Eric, maybe you can tell us that's a Florida thing. But I think we've got them here now, and they're driving me absolutely crazy. Ramona, our low last night was about 45. Wow, getting chilly out there. And I know some people are even approaching their frost date or maybe have already have it. So that actually leads us into the topic of today. I thought it would be a really good time to do this live stream today, since so many people are heading into cold weather. Now, we're not so much here in the southern climates, in the mild winter climates, or the frost-free zones, but many people are. And even if you're in a frost-free zone, it's still fun to get some things going indoors. And a lot of you have been watching our indoor garden series, following along with that, planting along with us on that one. And I gotta tell you, my full indoor garden is completely packed. I'm actually moving some of my fall vegetables outside, but you can either move some of your small indoor container plants inside for the winter time to get a little bit of a jump on things indoors, or you can start seeds indoors right now, which we're doing in our indoor garden series. So something that I started last week, in fact, it was on our indoor garden video we did last week, maybe it was 2 weeks ago, is some microgreens. So these are probably hands down, if you want to do some indoor growing from seed this winter, I want to say these are hands down the easiest thing you can grow indoors. You don't even need a grow light. Put them on your windowsill. They do like some indirect sunlight or grow lights. They'll do very well under grow lights. But it's just so fun to pick these. In about a week to 10 days, you're harvesting them, throwing them on those warm, cozy winter soups, on your scrambled eggs, putting them on top of your chicken or your fish dishes. They're so versatile, and there's so many different varieties that you can grow. So I highly recommend you plant some microgreens. We do have a full indoor garden seed collection specifically designed for growing from seed indoors. But what we're going to talk mainly focus on today is bringing some of your small container plants inside. Why do you want to do this? Because you do want to keep the fresh veggies going, keep a nice, steady, fresh supply of vegetables going in your house during the wintertime. Now, some of you might think that, okay, maybe you've been gardening all summer long, you're getting a little bit burnt out on it. I get that. Take a little break, but not too long, because I guarantee it, if you're in a cold winter area, you might enjoy the break at first from being out in the hot sun for sure. But after about a month or so in, you're gonna kind of get like, oh man, where are my fresh veggies? Where's my green? I miss being in my garden. I miss getting out and gardening. So I highly encourage you to start now. So when those winter blues hit, when you're starting to go stir crazy on the long, cold winter days and nights, which are not my favorite in the least, you will have some green inside to lift your spirits. And what I would recommend, so that's number one, why we want to do it. Number two, what do you want to bring inside? Now, I don't recommend bringing in your indeterminate tomato plants that get 10 feet tall, or your big long vining vegetables, or even your zucchini squash. I like to stick with smaller plants, and I highly recommend that to anyone, because you know what? You might have great intentions, but you get those big, huge vegetables inside. Number one, you're not going to have the space for it unless you have a huge house. Even if you do have a huge house, the most challenging thing I think about for a big plant like that is grow lights, making sure it has enough light. So if you've got a big sunny, like a sunroom or something like that, you might be able to do that. And if it gets lots and lots of direct sunlight, that might be an option for you, but that is kind of the more difficult way to go. So keep it simple. And I recommend bringing some of your smaller container plants. So I brought some up here on the deck that you guys could see some examples. So I would recommend like this pepper plant here in this 5 gallon smart pot is really the perfect size and the perfect plant to bring inside. Peppers are, for the most part, nice compact vegetables. You can keep them to a manageable size by pruning them. They do like to overwinter pretty well. So even in a cold climate, you can overwinter them outside if you mulch them and protect them really well. In southern climates, you can very easily overwinter them, but they will do very well inside as long as you provide them with some light. And there's Mac chasing the birds. He loves to do that. So a couple examples are that pepper plant back there. Herbs are great to grow inside or move inside during the winter. Here we have our little, this is our basil from our Grow Your Groceries with Calochem subscription box. And I have to say, I love this basil. We had some family, actually, our daughter brought some friends over last night. I had this little cute pot sitting on the table, and we were able to just pick the basil and put it right on, guess what? Yes, our wood-fired pizza. So it's a super nice compact variety. So, and of course, you know, you can't go wrong with the Smart Pots 1 gallon breast cancer awareness pot that's in our October box. So choose yourself some smaller varieties. If you've got some growing already in your garden in containers, bring those small pots like the 1 gallons or the 5 gallons inside. And another great way to grow basil and bring it indoors is if you've got some basil in your garden beds, you want to propagate it and bring it inside. I mean, that is a no-brainer way to really get a head start over starting from seed. Is I just cut these from my existing basil plants from the raised bed back here behind me. And I've got videos on how to do this, but you just cut a little stem off your basil, stick it in water. And I like to add a couple drops of like the Vermistera worm tea or the Vitality. It will grow roots, you can propagate it, and you'll have an endless supply of basil. You can plant it in a little small container of soil, like the Cali Kim 1 gallons, or you can just put it in a small little container of soil, or just grow it in water. And that's a great way to very simply and easily have some herbs right at your fingertips. The other thing that you can grow inside during the winter are small little mini tomatoes or dwarf tomatoes. So back here, I've got some of the Tiny Tims, which have been over on my potting shelf, waiting for me to pot them up in a 5 gallon. But those are ones, if you've got some smaller plants like that sitting around, you can pot them up in a 5 gallon and bring them inside. So my favorites indoors to bring inside for the winter are my peppers, some small tomato plants, herbs, and of course, greens. Now we can grow greens here in the wintertime is the best time to grow them. If you can't and you're experiencing like some hard freezes coming up, plant some or transplant some, although they don't transplant super easily. But if you've got a container of greens, I've got one back here somewhere. Oh, there it is. That's something that you could easily bring inside too and provide enough light to have it produce for you on the inside. So lots and lots of good options for you. Now, if you're feeling a little bit more adventurous and you have a little bit more space, you can bring some of those larger containers inside. And here I've got my little container deck winter garden here with the 15 gallon Smart Pots. Now, these are amazing. I love these because they have the handles on them. So you can easily drag them in your house, drag them around wherever you need them. And this is the Costco 3-pack. So it's only $29 for the 3-pack. I mean, how much better of a price could you get? So if you're interested in doing that, grab that over at Costco.com, transplant some of your tomatoes or herbs in the larger pots, and you'll be doing really, really well in the wintertime. Okay, so that tells you the what, the when, and the why. So we're gonna get into, in the next tip, a little bit more. Oh, I forgot to say when. If you're heading into the 50s, 40s temperature range, you definitely want to get some of your warm weather outdoor plants brought into your living room or your kitchen now, before the weather gets too cold for them, before they get, you know, stunted by the cold weather, definitely before it freezes. So start working on that now, because you know, it's never too early to start planning for that, and you want to make sure that they're prepared. You're not rushing to get them in before the cold weather hits, because it does need to be done a little bit gradually. So we'll talk about that in just a moment too. Okay, let's head into the chat and I'll give you some more tips in just a moment, but let's see what questions you have about growing inside. It's a lot of fun and I know you're gonna absolutely love it. Just set a little corner aside and it's gonna really lift your spirits. Garden Obsessions is here. Welcome back. You've had quite a busy few weeks getting all moved. Hope you're getting settled in your new home. Great to see you again, and hope you're enjoying your new spot there. Southern Sky Tennessee Garden DIY. I love the basil propagating tip. We'll definitely be doing that to have fresh garden basil during the winter. It really is a no-brainer. And I always encourage people to don't forget to do that, because once the weather starts to dip down, I'd say the low 50s, maybe even into the 40s, your basil might start to look a little bit, you know, not so good. It might start to die off. So make sure that you do it early while your basil is still looking nice and leafy and looking great. Charlene, we've had a steady 86 degree Fahrenheit every day, a little cooler in the mornings at least. So yeah, the weather has been all over the place, all over the country. And the thing to keep in mind, even if you've got some hot days, like I mentioned, we've had lots of hot days. However, it's not near as intense as it is in the summertime because our hours of sunlight are a lot less. So maybe your nights are still hot. Our nights always cool down, but like in Arizona and some other southern areas in Florida, you might still have warm nights, but you're not going to have as intense of a day because the sunlight won't be out for quite as long. So that's something to keep in mind too. Okay, let's see here. Joyce, how are you doing, Joyce? I believe, yes, your order just shipped this morning. So it's on its way to you. You should have it in just a couple of days. Joyce says, I never thought to bring the pepper plants inside the house. I put them in my greenhouse or in the garage and thought about bringing them inside. All right, I like that. Okay, a greenhouse, they might still do okay depending on how cold your nights get. But if you get hard freezes and your greenhouse is not heated, it may heat up during the day, might retain some of that heat at night, but maybe not quite enough to keep them producing. So you might just kind of have to play with that a little bit. Okay, Julie again is going to propagate her basil, and I want all of you to go outside to your garden this afternoon. If you still have basil, it takes literally like 2 seconds to clip just a few, or maybe you want to do several little jars of basil for your windowsill, and you will be so glad you did. It will grow roots in probably about maybe 5 to 7 days, and you'll be able to get it planted in soil if you want to do it that way. Okay, Nicole said, I ordered the 3-month subscription box for October, November, and December, so you are ready to roll for your indoor winter garden. You are going to be all set because our boxes for the next several months, 3 months at least, will be all about indoor winter gardening because we are all about making you successful in growing your own groceries. That's what it's all about. Okay, let's see here. Next tip. I just realized the time is flying, so I gotta fly through the tips here. The next one is, before you bring your plants inside, please pay attention to this. You want to assess your plants, okay? So you do not want to be bringing inside a plant that is heavily bug infested or just diseased and dying off very, very badly, okay? You wanna make sure you're bringing inside your house healthy plants. So pick the best of the best. And you're not going to be able to bring all your containers inside, even though I know you're going to want to, because it is sad to see your plants die after the winter time, but make sure that you're bringing only healthy plants inside. And the reason for this is because inside, as I talked about on our video we did last week on controlling pests on the indoors, inside there's no natural predators to take care of the bugs. So, you know, outside if you get aphids, you may have some ladybugs come by and take care of them for you. We've had a lot of praying mantis lately, which has been really great to see, but you don't have those natural predators on the inside. So you do not want to bring in any heavily pest infected plants. Now, that being said, what you can do, and I highly, highly recommend this, and let me see if I cover this. You know what, I'm gonna go ahead and cover tip number 4 before I do tip number 3. So it kind of goes along with what we're saying here. So after you've made your assessment, tip number 3 would be to prune and repot the plants that you're bringing in. Highly recommend this. So what I like to do is spray off anything that's been sitting outside, spray the plant off really, really well with a nice spray of water from your hose. Make sure it's good and rinsed off. And then I really do like to repot that plant because you may not be able to see any bugs that are in the soil or eggs that are in the soil. So I like to pull it out. Even you could even swish it like in a, you know, pull it out if you can get out by the roots pretty much and swish it even in a tub of water. A lot of the extra soil might sink to the bottom, or if you can just at least shake off a lot of extra soil and then repot it in fresh potting mix. And that way you have the least amount of chances possible of bringing in bugs into the house. There is always that chance. And then if that does happen, follow the video I did last week on how to get rid of them and you should be good to go. But it is really a pain when you get a lot of bugs in the house. So definitely repot fresh soil. You can sterilize your soil first, as I showed you how to do on last week's video. And that way it'll really, really cut down on the pests and bugs that you bring in. Before you repot it though, go ahead and prune off any like long scraggly branches or leaves or anything like that. any disease or pest infested parts of the tree or of the plant, anything that's like dead or dying, go ahead and prune all that off. So you're starting over with as much as possible a fresh plant that's nice and clean. And then once you do repot it, do make sure you give it a really nice feeding. You want it to really have a nice boost of growth when you're bringing it inside. So of course, you guys know my favorites, the Vermistera Vitality and the Worm Tea. I don't recommend using fish fertilizer, even though it's higher in nitrogen, in your house because it really smells. So I pretty much just stick to the Vermistera products indoors. Had great success with that. It's a great natural root hormone. Rooting hormone really helps the roots develop, and it really helps the plant be healthier, which cuts down on the bugs and all that kind of thing in the house. So a few little tips. Tip number two, assess your plants. Tip number three is prune and repot. Okay, with that all being said, I've been talking for a while, so I want to head into the chat, see what questions you might have on pruning and repotting. Okay, Michelle. Great tip here, one I did not mention in last week's video, but I love this tip. I've used this many, many times. For gnats, I make a trap with apple cider and dish soap, and that works great too. You just put them in a little bottle cap or something like that. You can set them around your plants. The yellow sticky traps work great. Oh, I think I've got this on my microgreens. Oh, look, a fly actually got stuck to it while it was sitting out here. Lots of fungus gnats on it, but a fly got stuck to it. So one last fly to bother me here. But these yellow sticky traps are amazing. And there's a link in the indoor garden video from last week on where you can grab these. They're very inexpensive on Amazon. However, when you purchase our Grow Your Groceries boxes, you have two in each month's box. So you've got these in here. Okay, you guys, I gotta tell you that the Grow Your Groceries October box, the gifted boxes are almost sold out. I was just checking our inventory this morning. So if you want a gifted box for October, we're honoring breast cancer, anyone impacted by breast cancer awareness. So it's a great gift if you have a friend who's going through that or has gone through that. You get free gift with your box is this beautiful Smart Pots breast cancer awareness pot. And the sticky traps, which I mentioned, are in there. But the seeds this month are so great for indoor growing. The Tom Thumb, tiny little tomato plant, very productive. Oh, this is the Micro Tom. The spicy basil, which I showed you. The dill seeds, which is great. And there's one other one. The Tom Thumb peas. So a great little selection there, but the gift boxes are almost sold out. So I highly recommend grab one sooner rather than later. And you can get $5 off your box with the code MINIVEGGIES. Okay, let's see what's going on in the chat here. The discount tip for Vermistera, yeah, 10% off with the code CALLIKIM. Want you to have the resources you need to keep things very cost effective for you. Bruce, hi, great to see you here. Planning to augment the Tiny Tim, the Gold Nugget, and Micro Tom tomatoes from the boxes. Yes, that orange or Gold Nugget is great. We just harvested some last night for our pizza, but that would be a good one to grow inside too. It's a little bit bigger than the Tiny Tim. Those can grow 3 to 4 feet tall, maybe 3 feet. So keep that in mind, just planning for your space. And the orange hat tomatoes from Baker Creek. And I have not tried that, so I'm not familiar with that. If anyone has, let Bruce know, and we can all learn and get some good resources here going in the chat also. Okay, lots of good suggestions for mosquitoes. So make sure you're reading through the chat as well. And by the way, if you weren't aware, the live stream does upload as a replay. You can watch it as a replay if you missed it. And you can also read through the chat on that. There's just so much valuable information in the chat each and every week. So thank you so much, all of you, for everything you contribute. Okay, let's see here. Let me scroll back through and see if we have any other questions or comments that we can answer before we move along here. Okay, I think, oh, pretty girl, great. Great to have you here. Finally able to catch you live due to the holiday. Louisa Gardner, I love watching you. Oh, yes, I think it is Columbus Day today, right? So maybe some people are off. In fact, I wonder if we get mail today. I have all my packages out front ready for pickup. I'll have to check on that. Okay. All right. Let's move on to Tip number three, and this is pretty important too. All these are great important tips on how to get your indoor garden growing. And that is, make sure that you check things out inside. Postal is closed. Okay. I don't know why I didn't think of that, but if you got a notice saying your package is shipping today, it's actually shipping tomorrow. So my bad on that one. I totally forgot about the postal holiday. Okay. Anyway, make sure that you're preparing a spot for your plants. Now, you may, if you have a very, very sunny window and some of your plants are good and established, you may have pretty good luck with them, like in a sunroom or in a bay window. Oh, just hope the umbrella doesn't tip. That gets, you know, a good 6 to 8 hours of light. However, a lot of people don't have that. So you guys have probably seen my indoor setup on our videos. I've got a corner kind of our dining room dedicated to my indoor growing. And I've got a whole shelf with grow lights set up. You don't have to get that elaborate. You can go very, very simple. And I brought one of my very favorite grow lights out here because it is the simplest way, I think, to get a grow light station set up. A lot of people are intimidated about grow lights. I know that, I realize that, and they can be costly. However, I try and give you cost-effective solutions. So one of my favorites is this clip light, which I actually have attached to the 15-gallon smart pot there with handles. I've got an indeterminate tomato in there. So it's a smaller variety of tomato, which you could do indoors. This will probably get about, maybe a little taller, maybe to the top of this tomato cage. So it could get about 3 feet tall. But you could easily clip this little grow light. It's just a little clamp light you could buy at Home Depot. Very common item. And it does have a special grow light bulb in it. But you can clamp it like to your little tomato cage here or to your cabinet. Put some microgreens or a little pot of lettuce underneath it. And you can literally get your grow light set up for $15. I think that's around $15 for that whole entire setup. All the links for that are over in my indoor garden series videos. So do make sure you check those if you're interested. I want you to have things that work. I don't want you to be wasting your money buying supplies and then buying other supplies because those don't work. Everything I link to, I do because I've tried it and it works and I want you to be successful. So do make sure you check that out. So this would be a smaller setup for a smaller plant or, you know, just one single plant like this tomato. If you want to have a bigger setup, I've got a whole video on how to get your grow light set up, whether it's a long shop light or a shelf, that type of thing. So there's lots of good, easy DIY setups. And you can search our channel for grow lights and several videos will pop up to help you get started on that. But I do recommend at least getting a small grow light setup going and not fully depending on windowsill or light from a window. It's just usually not quite enough to really make sure your plants are successful, and then you're gonna be frustrated. So even if you just have a small light set up, that's a great way to go. I do like to kind of keep my indoor plants in one spot. Maybe you don't have like a cabinet top or anything like that you can do. You could scatter them throughout your house if you want to. But then for me, like it's a little bit hard to remember, you know, to water them all. So I have everything hooked up to a timer. It shuts on, shuts off automatically. It's kind of takes the guesswork out of it. And then everything is growing in one area. It's a lot easier for me to water and maintain. So that's a system that has worked for me. Find something that works for you. But I would highly suggest that you follow some of those tips. Oh, and by the way, the grow light setup is also in my first book, Organic Gardening for Everyone. So you can grab that if you prefer to have it all written down and look at it and follow through it step by step. Okay, let me see if there's any other things on setting things up inside. The other great thing about moving it or setting up one location is usually in one spot, you can kind of, the temperature is kind of stable in that area. So if you've got your plants scattered all about or some next to windows where they might be cold, this umbrella was going to tip, where they might be cold or you might have leaky air coming through. If you have them in one area, the temperature could be fairly consistent and fairly stable in that one area. And Cliff, I couldn't agree with you more. Grow lights, just do it. You'll love it. You will not believe, it's so true, Cliff, you will not believe what a difference it will make in the growth of your indoor plants. So gear it for, or get it going now. And that way when spring comes, you're going to have a jump start on your spring planting. So I have something growing in my indoor grow lights pretty much year round. So make the effort. It's an investment, definitely, but one that you can use for many, many years. So well, well worth the investment. And yes, I agree with you, Smart Pots. LED lighting has come a long way. When I first started with grow lights, they only had the old like CFL grow lights. And this is super, super easy with the LEDs. Very, don't take up hardly any energy. And those bulbs last forever. I rarely replace my grow light bulbs. They last for years unless I bump up against it and drop one or they break or something like that. But yeah, a very good investment. And check the Indoor Garden series for all the links. Okay, let's go back into the tips here. Tip number five for bringing your plants inside is make sure that you allow some time for them to acclimate to the indoor growing conditions. Do you remember how when we're growing our spring vegetables inside or spring seedlings inside, we harden them off when we bring them outside? So we make that transition slowly from the indoors to the outdoors. Well, the same thing needs to be done when you're going in the reverse direction from the outdoors to the indoors. Acclimate them slowly. Just do that hardening off process in reverse because they're coming from outside where it's full sun. There's elements like the wind that just kicked up and they're going inside under grow lights or in a windowsill. You know, even a super bright grow light is not near as bright and intense as the sunlight is. So you don't want them to go into transplant shock. So, or just shock from moving, from changing conditions. So do yourself a favor, acclimate them slowly. So once you've cleaned the plants off and all that, bring them in for a few hours a day, back out in the sun, and basically just do that hardening off process in reverse. And go back and watch our hardening off videos. We have several of them. You can look under our Grow Your Grocery series, under our First Time Gardener series, or just pop in the little search field on our channel about transitioning plants or hardening off plants, and some videos will pop up for you to follow. So do make sure you do that, and the extra time that it takes is worth it. So that's why it's kind of a good idea, or it is a good idea, to keep an eye on the temperatures and on your first frost date. Check on almanac.com and kind of see what the average temperatures are in your area and when they dip down, so that we can start preparing and planning. You're not rushing the process all at once, and then all of a sudden you've got a frost, you've got to get your plants in, and it's a little bit too late at that point. So do keep an eye on your frost dates, or at weather.com has a great spot where you can see what your average temperatures are in your area for that time of the year. It's definitely a pay attention to that. Okay, here, let's go back to the chat here for a little bit and see what's going on. And Southern Sky, Tennessee Gardener. Oh, because of you, Callie, I have a whole grow light station set up in my garage and will be using it all winter to grow lettuce. I used to grow inside, but then we got a dog. So yeah, it's super easy to get set up. And once you do it, you're gonna wonder, why didn't I do this earlier? Because you're gonna see such a difference in the growth of your plants. Okay, grow lights are a game changer, says Patricia. A lot of people saying that. No problem, Southern Sky. Patricia, have you grown bunching onions indoors, or can you? Great question, Patricia. And yes, to both questions, you definitely can. I've started bunching onions many times indoors in the springtime, and they grow very well. You can transplant them outdoors, but that's also a nice small crop that you could grow indoors all winter and it would be just fine. The other great thing I love growing indoors are chives. I think chives are one of the herbs that I use the most. I've got tons of chives right behind me here in my herb garden, but those you can grow on a windowsill, get them started. I would say good and well under grow lights. They'll grow well on a windowsill, and it's so much fun to just snip and clip them into just about every single one of your recipes. Adds so much flavor. Okay, Charlene, Kim, you'll have to extend your indoor plant growing collection. Yeah, I think our indoor seed collection has about 10 varieties, but we do also have, it has some herbs, tomatoes, microgreens, and lettuce. But we do also have our microgreens collection, which has 10 varieties of microgreens, and that's a great one to grow indoors. And don't forget about our subscription boxes for the next 3 months. Indoor growing, and they do have seeds that are not in any other of my seed collections. So definitely a way that we've extended our seeds that we're making available to you this winter time. Okay, let's see here. Number six tip for moving your vegetables from the garden to the living room. Another super important tip is don't over water. Cannot emphasize this enough. Don't overwater, especially inside. And there's a couple of problems with overwatering. Number one, the fungus gnats, hopefully not mosquitoes inside, the fungus gnats, the bugs, they love it. They love growing in damp conditions. So if you're overwatering your plants, more chances are that they're going to land on your plants, lay their eggs. The larvae and the eggs will eat away at the roots of your plants, and you're going to have a big problem indoors. The other thing that loves to live in overly wet soil is mold and fungus and that type of thing. So if you overwater, you're definitely inviting those problems. Now, it does happen to all of us. I totally get that. But try and let the first few inches of your soil dry out just a bit before you water. And always do the finger test in your containers inside, where you're sticking your finger about an inch or so in, feeling if it's dry, and then watering. And when you do water, and by the way, we've had a lot of questions on watering indoors lately, so I will be doing an indoor watering video probably this week. But when you do water, I like to water my plants just in place on the shelf with a little watering can. Make sure you water from the bottom. So you're just going to be pouring some water. Whoops, that one's overflowing. Some water in your little tray there, and then letting it soak up from the bottom. And that way you're not overwatering from the top or splashing, you know, the fungus from soil to soil, from plant to plant. And it's just a much healthier way to water. So once the plant does soak up the water, make sure you pour off the water so you're not leaving any standing water, which is more breeding ground for bugs. And just do be very careful not to overwater your plants, because then you can cause root rot on the inside, and it's just causes almost as many problems as underwatering. So definitely be paying attention to that. Okay. And the other thing to keep in mind is you're not going to be watering your plants the same inside as you do outside, depending on your growing conditions. Obviously outdoors, they're in the bright sun. They're going to be drying out quicker if you're not getting any rain. Inside, depending on how hot your house is or cool your house is. So you just kind of have to keep an eye on things. Always check your plants daily and just make sure you're really paying attention to the types of the water that they do need, and only watering when they need it. There's no magic answer for how often do I water? How much do I water? It really depends on the individual plants that you're growing. So with all those tips here, hopefully that will definitely make you a lot more successful in acclimating your plants to the inside, moving them from the garden to the living room or the dining room or the kitchen or wherever you might be growing your indoor garden. And it will help you be a lot more successful in growing some veggies during the winter. So make sure you get started. And I want to know here in the chat is who is planning on getting started on this week, and tell me one thing you're going to do or one plant that you would like to move inside. I would love to hear about it now in the chat. We've got a few minutes left in the stream to answer some questions before we close things out here. Okay, Bruce Vivers, and this brings up a great point too, is if you have a lot of 5-gallon grow bags, get an undercar drip tray from the auto parts store. So that's a great suggestion. And that would fit nicely on a shelf. And you could put several of your smart pots right there on that drip tray. So very good suggestion. And I have had a couple of questions too about drip trays. And yes, I always use drip trays inside. So I obviously don't want water running into my grow lights. That could be a big problem. And I believe I put a link for these small ones that fit under the 1 gallons in our indoor garden videos. I'll also add a link for this larger one. I think it's a 13 inch and this is a 7 inch that fit under the 5 gallons, so that you can, get those under your trays or under your pots. And I think for the 15 gallons, if you're moving a 10 or a 15 gallon inside, I love that suggestion, Bruce, of the oil pan. That would probably fit really nicely under those, and you could keep them in a corner of your living room or wherever. Okay, Marilyn, great news, Marilyn. I'm going to start lettuce this week indoors. Get it started. It'll grow so fast. You're going to love harvesting it in about 6 weeks. And Charmac, I need to try some chives also inside. Yeah, one of my very, very favorite things to do. Smile Urban Gardens, I'm in the process of moving several pepper plants indoors for the winter. It's a nice sunny day, so it's a perfect time. And yes, while it's still warm out, before it gets too cold and you don't even want to go outside anymore, start that whole process going. Okay, Lorraine, thank you. Great suggestion. You can also use a cat litter box as a drip tray. I never thought of that. It's a very good one too. And Ramona, I have a few plants that I'll be bringing in: banana, moringa, orange, and turmeric. Wow. That is great. You're going to have a fun time doing that. And hopefully you have a good little space in there that you can grow those. I know a lot of people too do bring in their citrus. If you've got a potted lemon plant growing, they do really well in the smart pots. But if you're getting frost and cold weather, citrus will not do real well outside. So you can definitely overwinter those on the indoors. And there's lots of YouTube videos on how to do that. But that's always a good idea too, if you live in a colder zone, to bring in your potted citrus plants as well. Okay, let's scroll down through here. Felicia, I'm going to start lettuce in my arrow garden. That's a great way to grow as well. Super easy to grow on your countertop. And 808 Ladybug started my bulb onions indoors. Wow, good start on that, 808 Ladybug. And you live in Hawaii, so it's a perfect time to get that going. Bruce, tomatoes, lettuce, basil, and some to-be-determined herbs. Okay, great idea, all great things. And can you imagine just walking over to your corner of your living room and picking a fresh salad? And with a little micro toms, you can throw those on there. I just love this plant. I'm waiting, trying to wait patiently for these beautiful little tomatoes to get red. But imagine picking these from the corner of your living room shelf under your grow lights and putting them on your fresh lettuce that you grew yourself. And these are the ones that are in the October box, and they are just an adorable little plant. And it's so much fun to see all that green. Okay, thank you so much, everyone, for hanging out here with us today. And don't forget, grab your October, either your subscription boxes or your gifted boxes, almost sold out, with the code Mini Veggies for $5 off. And then 25% off all of our seed collections, our 1 gallon smart pots, 5 gallon, 10 gallons, all of our smart pots, books, and garden kits. So grab your indoor garden kit, and that code for that is Indoor Garden. So get those. No live stream for 2 weeks. We're back on the 30th. And thank you so much for hanging out here. And we are very excited to be back again in 2 weeks and a couple of videos this week. So be looking for those. And Jerry's going to be out here zapping bugs for the next 2 weeks. I'll guarantee it. We'll be very busy with that. So thanks for hanging out, guys. Yes. And we will see you next week.
No, we won't.
No, sorry,
no,
2 weeks.
No, no, no.
I'm so used
Stop
to saying
it. That. Stop the tape. Stop the tape.
We'll see you on the 30th. All right. Take care, everyone. Bye-bye.
Bye.